I would like to present to you some information about how the European Programme on Research and Innovation is supporting the sector of development of technologies in energy efficiency in buildings. And as you probably know, there was a new multi-annual program that started a little bit more than a year ago, the so-called Horizon 2020. And the sector of energy efficiency in buildings has received the treatment of a key strategic sector for European research and innovation. Article 25 of the regulation for the new framework program allows the implementation of parts of the program in the case of research and innovation of strategic importance through what we call public-private partnerships. And when deciding what could be the main areas where this would be making sense, the area of construction, the area of energy efficiency in buildings has been selected as one of them. A few months ago, after already the start of Horizon 2020, there was a new commission, the so-called Juncker Commission, and there is a new strategy for Europe, which has 10 main lines. And it is very important to see that the public-private partnerships that were launched at the beginning of Horizon 2020 for research and innovation activities are well in line with these priorities of Juncker, in particular with some of the most important ones. And if you see in the case of energy efficient buildings, PPP, we are contributing to a new boost for jobs, growth and investment, for a connected digital single market, for the resilient energy union, and also the deeper and fairer internal market. And why not? We are also contributing to have Europe as a stronger global actor, because nowadays European enterprises are operating in a globalized world, and the competitiveness of those enterprises makes Europe a much stronger global actor. The new framework program for research and innovation has some key elements which are very important for industry. In particular, it is organized according to three pillars, and together with the pillar of societal challenges and the pillar of excellence in science, there is one which is devoted to industrial competitiveness. There is also a much more emphasis and a much more push towards innovation than in previous framework programs, and this means that we want to continue with the activities after the results of the research projects to, in order to make sure that those results lead to products and end up in giving benefits to society and to industry. As I mentioned, in the case of industrial technologies, there is a specific pillar, but there is also the opportunity to implement the research and innovation activities through partnerships with industry, and in particular, we have two types, the institutional PPPs that continue with the activities that you might know from joint technology initiatives, and the new contractual PPPs, which build on the basis of what was developed already for energy efficient buildings under the recovery plan. Indeed, in the last 4 years of the previous framework program, the so-called FP7, there was already an experience of building partnerships in three sectors which were essential for the European economy. One was the factories of the future, another one was energy efficient buildings, and the third one was green vehicles. And at the end of the framework program, there was an assessment of how this had contributed to a better implementation, and it was found that they had been quite successful. There had been a much quicker response to defining the strategy via roadmaps prepared by industry. We had in total 366 projects supported, And what is very important, we have managed to attract back to the framework program industrial partners. One of the problems of the European framework program was that there was a low industrial participation, and also in particular participation of SMEs. And with the PPPs, we managed to increase much more the participation to a figure of 57% of participations from industry in general and 25% of SMEs. And then also, even though these partnerships were not structural in the sense of having a specific regulation for them and that the budgets were still indicative, in the end it was shown that the budget was used and it had some leverage of around 2.4 billion for the three PPPs. So then when preparing the new framework program, we had to decide about how to implement the different activities, and it was thought that it was a good idea to continue with this type of partnerships because they are win-win situations. For the industry, it means that there is support from the public side in order to strengthen European industrial leadership in this globalized economy. But also for the public side, there are clear advantages. We facilitate the right prioritization of the research and innovation goals, because we do that together with the industry, bringing together the public objectives with the industry needs. And also we managed to achieve a much better leverage of our money, because then industry is also investing in those sectors of interest. In the assessment at the end of FP7 with regard to these PPPs of the recovery package, it was also found that there was no such close club effect in the PPPs. There was a concern, a legitimate concern, that the people who were involved in the partnership more directly in order to contribute to the preparation of the strategy could have advantage, and that the projects might be ending up in a small number of partners. But it was shown that this was not the case. In the associations that were helping the European Commission to implement those PPPs, the projects and the funding going to them was in the level of around 30%, showing that they were representative of the sectors involved, but that it was still a very open initiative where around 70% of the money and 75% of the participation were going to partners outside those associations. So then in the new framework program, we decided to continue with the three existing PPPs, Factories of the Future, Energy Efficient Buildings, and Green Vehicles, also with the one on the future internet, which had been launched a little bit later, and to launch new ones. And there was one for the process industry, which is also cross-sectorial, and then there were several new PPPs launched in the area of communication and information technologies. How were the PPP selected? The legislation for Horizon 2020 gives some criteria. It has to be areas of clear European added value and where there's going to be an important impact. And there has to be a critical scale and a long-term nature for the industrial commitments. And in particular, in the case of Horizon 2020, the partnerships are set up through the signing of a contractual arrangement between the public and the private side. So how were then these partnerships created in practice? The associations representing the industrial sector or the industrial community, involving as well research centers and the universities, which were stakeholders for that in the industrial sector, they prepared a roadmap. Those roadmaps were then submitted to stakeholders' consultations of several months, and they were improved in that way. Then in the spring of 2013, they were finally presented to the European Commission. There was an evaluation by a high-level expert group. And at the beginning of Horizon 2020, there was the signing of a contractual arrangement which already specifies an indicative budget, and it specifies as well the roadmap of the activities that are envisaged. So for external stakeholders, what is similar to the rest of the framework program and what could be different things in the case of PPPs? It is important that the financial rules and the rules for participation are similar to the rest of the framework program because it facilitates a lot the participation. The final responsibility for the preparation of the work program stays with the European Commission, which means also that it ensures the transparency and the openness of the programs. And also the organization of the evaluations and the payments and review of progress is also in the hands of the Commission. This helps as well the involvement of the member states. But then what is different from normal Horizon 2020? Here there is a clear long-term commitment by the Commission to support the field for the 7 years of the framework program. There is also a long-term commitment by industry to invest. And this is something which is in the contractual arrangement, but also it has to be monitored. There are some indicators that have to be evaluated year after year in order to see that we are in the right track. And then, contrary to other parts of the framework program, here we are implementing roadmap-based strategy, which means that we have already prepared in advance what should be the key areas of our strategy, and these are already known. This is a public document, and so everybody can already prepare a little bit in advance to the calls that are going to be launched. This contractual arrangement, which was a new thing in Horizon 2020, defines the roles of the public and the private side, and it also gives the specific objectives of the research to be carried out, the governance aspects, and already the commitments from both sides with regard to budget and with regard to key performance indicators which are going to be monitored. One of these PPPs is devoted to the area of energy efficient buildings. I think I don't need to convince you of the fact that this sector is very important for the European economy. More than 14 million direct jobs, and of course many other jobs are related to these activities. And it is also a sector where there is a huge number of SMEs. Due to the current crisis, there was a decrease in turnover, and it is clearly justified not only to support it because of the crisis, but also because the new technologies in this sector are going to facilitate the achievement of important European goals, like, for example, the climate goals, the decrease in the use of total energy in order to have more efficient technologies, and also the decrease in the related emissions. In the case of the energy efficient building sector, the energy efficiency will come in a big way through the refurbishment of the existing buildings which were not designed very efficiently when they were constructed a couple of decades ago or several decades ago. And since there is little incentive to have a quick replacement rate, the need to have technologies which are cost effective and that would attract investors to use them in the existing buildings is also very important, and that justifies the use of public support. So in this initiative, the goals are defined in the contractual arrangement, and here there is the main objective is to develop technologies enabling to speed up a reduction in energy and greenhouse gas emissions related to buildings, and to have those technologies developed so that they can be cost effective. There is also, of course, overall goals of reduction of energy use and reduction of emissions. and also some other objectives linked to making sure that the construction industry becomes a smart industry, becomes a highly advanced industry, which is competitive in global terms. The arrangement also mentions a number of indicators, and they are at two levels. Some are to check that we are in the good track to support the goals, both the public energy and climate goals, and also the goals of industry. And also at the project level, it's very important that the contributions are found, and that also the projects give results which are going to facilitate take-up of technologies in the market for the benefit of society. So this contractual arrangement also has as the annex the roadmap, and the roadmap has three main parts. It's the vision of the European construction industry with regard to energy efficiency. The second part gives already the research and innovation strategy, and here the main drivers include design, structure, envelope, equipment, the process, performance monitoring, etc. And there is also a very important section, the part three, which is already a kind of impact assessment. When we prepared this document, it was important to show that the goals could be reached thanks to the technologies to be developed. The governance of the partnership is very simple compared to the more structuralized partnerships. Here, it is basically a partnership board involving the representatives of the two sides, where the strategic issues are discussed, where the calls are prepared, and where also the monitoring can be done together. Already in 2014, there was a call for the Energy Efficient Buildings PPP for a total of 62.5 million. The PPP involves the strongest part is coming from the pillar of industrial leadership, and that's what we used to call NMP, nanotechnology, materials, and production sectors. But it is a cross-cutting PPP in the sense that also the challenges of energy and environment are contributing both to the strategy definition, to a good coordination between the different parts of the framework program, to the discussions with industry, and also to the support of projects. And the areas covered in 2014 included materials for the building envelope, adaptable envelopes, self-inspection technologies, prefabricated modules, and also energy strategies for the renovation of historic buildings. There was a call in 2015. Here it was also involving support from NMP and support from the energy challenge. The total here was 71.5 million, and the areas covered included design tools for refurbishment, thermal energy storage, retrofitting of residential buildings, and also new highly energy performance buildings. If I concentrate a little bit on the overview of what was done in the largest part of the budget, which was the one linked with NMP, which is where we are responsible for, there were very good responses to the calls. We received around 100 proposals in each of the 2 years, and it was possible to select around a dozen of projects in each of the years. Having a look at the type of participations, we are very happy to show that 54% of the participations came from industry, and then 21% from technological centers, 18% from universities, and then public institutions and other type of participants. So this is much higher industrial participation and compared to the average participation of industry in the framework program. And it is very good also that close to 50% is also shared equally between research and technology centers and universities, which are very important also for making sure that the innovations are advanced. When we analyze the participation of SMEs, it's also very important to see that overall, one third of the participations are coming from SMEs. And this is also much higher than the very ambitious target of 20% that has been set in Horizon 2020. We are now preparing the work program for 2016 and 17, and the expected publication of the work program and the new calls will likely take place in September of this year. And we have already in the last few months been discussing with our partners in the research and industrial community linked with energy efficient buildings, and also with the member states. And the areas being considered for the calls of 2016 include at present insulation materials, monitoring techniques for energy efficiency, integration of technologies for heating and cooling, and also the development of prefabricated elements through recycling. And the areas considered for 2017, which in a way are complementing the previous one because we are now having two-year work programs, would include near zero energy renovation, hybrid storage solutions for power and heat, the integration of energy harvesting, and also new business models in this sector. And just to finalize, because I think it's not only the governance, it's not only the partnership in macro terms that counts. The richness of this program is it's, in particular the projects and the results obtained by the projects. And I would like to mention two types of projects. The first one is an example of activities in new buildings, very close to zero energy buildings. And project Need for B is a six-year project which started in 2012. The overall budget is close to 10 million and 5.7 million are provided from the European budget. There are 15 partners in total. And here they have a very ambitious target to have a common target of consumption lower than 60 kilowatt hour per square meter per year. And in order to develop technologies which are ready for those challenges, they have planned five demo sites with a total area of 27,000 square meters. Three of them are already constructed in Turkey and Sweden and in Italy. And two additional demo sites, which will be in Belgium and in Spain, are expected in late 2015. And they're already monitoring the energy consumption in the three sites which are constructed. And results are already coming, and the project is already quite advanced. So this is an example of what's being done in the technology for new buildings. Then another example for refurbishment of technologies is a project RetroKit. As I mentioned, it's very important that we take account also of the large amount of buildings which are not energy efficient but were already constructed some years ago. And in particular, there are a high number of multi-story residential buildings which would need retrofitting in order to become energy efficient. This project is aiming to develop a retrofit toolbox that can integrate flexible prefabricated solutions in order to upgrade the building and its envelope. And here there is also a global target of 50 kilowatt hour per square meter per year of energy consumption, in particular in order to take it as a factor in the decision on whether or not to retrofit. And they have identified three demo buildings in three different climatic zones. The one in Spain is already completing and the monitoring is running, and the other two in Germany and in Finland are already designed, and the work is ongoing now to make them operational. But I would like to mention that it's not just the projects. There is also an emphasis on energy efficient buildings as a community working together, and that's also an advantage of having a PPP. We have year after year impact workshops where we analyze together and with the participation of all the running projects, what else can be done, how can we have additional value, and how can we identify gaps, and how can we do demonstration or dissemination together. And as a result of those activities, we have generated clusters, and we have also had additional funding to support clusters, and a very good example is the cluster Amanak for construction materials and insulation materials in particular, and how this can contribute to energy efficiency, which is also a very good success, and it's already started to have meetings yesterday, and they are going to have meetings also during this international congress. So I would like to finalize by inviting you all to consider, if you are not already convinced, that it could be in your interest to participate in the European program for energy efficient buildings technologies. And we hope that you are successful if you prepare proposals and that you can form part of this community of the EEB public-private partnership. Thank you very much.